In the previous lecture, we have seen the concepts of gear metrology. Now we are going to see some other devices with the help of which we can take the dimensions or measure the dimensions of a screw thread or a spur gear or tools. So one instrument which is called as a profile projector can be used to make some measurements. So this is a very simple image of a profile projector. So basically it is a versatile, highly sophisticated and easy to operate optical instrument that is used for checking the profile of objects having small and complex parts, regular and irregular profiles. So it is ideal for rapid inspection of linear and angular dimensions of small and medium sized components such as tools, gears, screw threads. Now how it works? The optical system of this projector provides accurate, bright, clear and sharp image of the objects being inspected. So as you can see, one optical system is there. There is a lens is there, then there is a provision of the bulb is there, okay, and this is the work table, XY table. Here the object has to be mounted and the image of this object is projected on this projector screen. This is a projector box, so this is a projector screen. So this screen, it can be rotated through 360 degree with the help of the screen rotation knob. So this is screen rotation knob. If you rotate this screen this knob, this entire screen can be rotated through 360 degree. There are film holders are there. Then this is the lens control panel. Here is the control panel. With the help of this Z axis handwheel, we can control the focus of this projected image. We can sharpen this image as per our requirement. These are the level adjusting screws. So what it does, whatever small component is there, the image of that small component is enlarged by the optical system of this profile projector, and that is projected on this rotatable screen. So the image is this, whatever image is produced, that can be positioned in any position with the help of this rotating screen, and the workpiece is placed on this table which is mounted on ball bearings. This work table can move in X and Y direction. Sometimes there can be digital readouts, or sometimes in some cases micrometers are attached to these two tables, two independent micrometer. One micrometer can measure the dimension in X direction, another in Y direction. So that type of the measurements can be done. So it is easy. So just project the image and take the readings with the help of the these two micrometers. So again, this is very simple image. You can see same image, same sketch, slightly you can say still more elaborating. So this is the glass screen which can be rotated with the help of this scale rotation wheel. You can, this is the another view, side view you can say. Then these are the lenses, so lenses of various magnifications, 10x 20x. Then illumination light is there, so this the light can be projected or focused on this component. The component is going to be here, workstage moving wheel. So this is the wheel with the help of which you can move the workstage. This is the actual workstage. Illumination light from the bottom. Here also the illumination light is provided, that will go from here and it will pass through the object. Then is, there is a control panel. This is a focusing wheel. This wheel is used to focus the image. So this is actual example of the profile projector. This is the profile projector which is available in our laboratory. So as you can see, this is a control panel. Then this is the illumination light. This is a focusing wheel. With the help of this we can sharpen the image. This is actual work table. So this work table can move in two independent directions. So you can see, and these work tables are equipped with two micrometers. So this is one micrometer, this is another micrometer. So this micrometer can measure the movement in one direction, this micrometer can measure the movement in another direction. This is the workpiece. You can see one screw thread is mounted and its image is projected here. This is the projector screen. It is a glass screen which can be rotated with. This is the screen rotation knob. This, if you rotate this knob, this screen is going to rotate. So the image of the screw is projected, and now we can measure. Once this image is projected, this is an enlarged image. So once this image is projected, we can measure the various parameters of the this screw thread. So one reference is provided, that is a cross line is provided in this projector screen. So we have to just align on that cross line and we have to take the readings. Whatever reading you want to take, you just align the cross line. Suppose you want to measure the major diameter. So first align the cross line here at this position. Okay, just by moving the table in this direction, in vertical direction. Then at this position, note down the reading of the micrometer, this micrometer. Then again move the table with the help of this micrometer. Take the cross line here, match, align the cross line at the tip of this particular gear, and take another reading of the micrometer. The difference between previous reading and another reading, latest reading, that is nothing but the major diameter. Similarly, you can find out the minor diameter. We can find out the thread angle. For measuring the thread angle, we have to rotate the this screen rotation knob, and we have to align the flank of this particular thread with the cross line, and to have the angular dimensions, this screen has been provided with this scale is there. This on this screen here, the angular scale is provided, that is between 0 to 360 degrees. So this angular scale is provided, so we can make any kind of measurement with the help of this profile projector. One experiment is mentioned in your syllabus regarding this profile projector. So you have to actually measure the major dimension, minor diameter, major diameter, minor diameter, pitch and thread angle of a screw thread. That you have to do. You are going to do this experiment in the laboratory. Then this expression, this then one more equipment is there, that is a tool that is called as a tool maker microscope. So it is similar to the profile projector, but you can say it is a smaller version, and many times it is whatever functions which are carried out by the profile projector, same characteristics or dimensions can be measured with the help of the tool makers microscope. So you can see, this is the column. On this column there is a one unit is there. So in that unit there is eyepiece, there is a focusing knob, okay, surface illuminator, clamping screw. So this entire unit is clamped with the supporting column with the help of this clamping screw. So what you have to do, this is the work table. This work table can move again in x and y direction, okay, and you have to put the component here, and again illumination will be provided, and whatever image of the component is there, that you have to see through the eyepiece. Here there is an eyepiece, okay. So through this eyepiece you can again cross line or crosshair is provided, and you have to take the readings. So here again we can take the variety of readings. Protractor ocular with two angular scales is provided, okay. So it can, here there is a angular scale here, okay. So you can take the angular dimensions with the help of this angular scale, okay. So and linear dimensions can be taken with the help of the 2 micrometers. Again there are 2 micrometers on this work table. 1 micrometer can measure the dimension in one direction, another in another dimension. So you can take the dimensions similar to profile projector. This is the actual image of the toolmaker's microscope. So as you can see, this is the control panel, okay. This is the work table on which you are going to maintain the component. So this work table can move in x and y direction. So these work tables are equipped with 2 independent micrometers. So if you rotate this micrometer, it is going to move the table in one direction. If you rotate this micrometer, it is going to move the table in another direction. And we can put the component here, see the component through this eyepiece. This is the eyepiece through which you have to see the component. This is the provision for the illumination. So light is provided. Again that one more light will come below from the bottom, okay. And this is one a protractor ocular with 2 scales. So here this is the angular scale. With the help of this angular scale we can take the angular dimensions. With the help of these 2 micrometers we can take the linear scale, and we can find out the various parameters of a screw thread or gear or single point cutting tool. Like that we can find out. So this is the tool maker's microscope. Now the next part in this unit number 2 is a measurement of the surface roughness. So it is a slightly ignored part in as far as the quality control is concerned. Nowadays surface roughness measurement is considered as one of the important parameters in quality control. So we have to assess the surface finish of a component by various methods, okay. So as you can see, one surface is shown to you. Now before going to surface, we need to study or we need to discuss why the surface roughness measurement is so important, okay. So factors affecting surface finish, okay. How the surface finish is generated, which parameters are responsible for producing a particular type of surface finish. First factor that affects the surface finish is the type and condition of the workpiece, okay. The type and condition of the workpiece means which type of the workpiece is there, in what condition it has been received, in what condition it is being processed. Depending upon that, the surface finish is what kind of surface finish is going to be achieved, that can be predicted. Then type of the operation mean which type of the operation you are carrying out, whether you are say doing the machining, whether you are doing the say whether you are gear cutting, in whether you are carrying out the finishing operation or super finishing operation, whether you are doing grinding, whether you are forging, so milling, whether you are casting. So depending upon what kind of manufacturing process is being used, that manufacturing process decides what kind of surface finish is expected from that particular manufacturing process. Every manufacturing process is having its own limitations. Okay, so the manufacturing processes like casting, forging will have a very limited surface finish, whereas the surface finish of the super finishing operation like lapping, honing, they will have high surface finish, isn't it? So type of operation also decides the type of the surface finish we are going to get. Then third is the shape, condition and geometry of the workpiece. Okay, so what is the shape, what is the geometry, that also decides the surface finish. The cutting parameters like speed, feed and depth of cut, these are also the very important parameters that decide the surface finish of the component. Then deflection of the tool or workpiece. So means how rigid your system is. Your system must be highly rigid if you want to go, if you want good surface finish. The workpiece should not get deflected, or the tool should not get deflected due to the cutting forces. Then cutting fluids used. So if you use the cutting fluid, obviously you are going to get the good surface finish. So what kind of cutting fluid is used, in which, what quantity it is being used, so that also decide the surface finish you are going to get. So these are some of the factors that decides the surface finish. Now why it is necessary to produce smooth surface? Why? We many times we are not aware the importance of the surface finish. We look at only few critical characteristics. We measure the dimensions, we measure the mechanical properties, and we don't assess the quality of the surface finish. So what is the effect of surface finish on performance of the component? There is a definite relation between the surface finish and performance of the component. First necessity of producing smooth surface is good appearance. Means if your surface is smooth, then the appearance of the component is going to be good. Definitely it is going to be good appearance. Then good strength. So smooth surface provides the good strength to the component. Then bearing load capacity. The bearing load capacity of the smooth surface is always better than the rough surface. So it is very important. So from design point of view, good strength, load carrying capacity, these are very important parameters. Corrosion, wear and fatigue resistance. So this is very important. If you want the less corrosion, less wear and more fatigue resistance, then you need smooth surface. Noise reduction. So if your surface is smooth, then it reduces the noise during the operation. Longer life. The smooth surface has longer life. Then surface texture characteristics. So I had shown you one sketch this is the sketch related to surface texture characteristics. So you can see this is one of the surface which is shown to explain you. So you can see this is the surface, one surface. Then this there is a roughness, waviness, roughness width, waviness width. So what are these points? So as you can see, roughness and waviness are the part of the surface texture characteristics. So roughness means a surface will not be perfectly smooth if you see it under the microscope, or if you see it under after magnification, you will some kind of say roughness. So that roughness may contain the so that is called as irregularities. Surface is rough means it is said that the surface is irregular, it is not regular. So if those irregularities are fine, if fine regularities are there in the surface texture, which arise or what is the source, why it is happen? Because it is the inherent action of the production process. It is the property of that production process due to which the fine irregularities have arisen. And so these include the irregularities of the third and fourth order. These are called as the irregularities of the third and fourth order. So basically the word fine irregularities is very important, and third and fourth order irregularities of the third and fourth order, these words are very important. Then waviness. Waviness, if you compare the roughness with the waviness, it is the wide spaced undulation of the surface texture. Means as compared to the roughness, waviness is somewhat wider. Okay, so it results from the factors such as machine or work deflections. Why it has happened? Because either machine has deflected or work has deflected, due to which these irregularities have seen. It may be due to the vibrations, it may be due to chatter, heat treatment or warping stress. So it includes irregularities of the first and second order. These are the irregularities of the first and second order. So word wide spaced undulation and irregularities of the first and second order are very important in this case. Spacing, it is the average distance between the more predominant irregularities on the profile. Flaws, so if you see the flaw, these are the irregularities at one place. So as you can see, there may be flaw somewhere. Okay, so these are called the irregularities of the like there may be a blowhole on the surface, there may be crack, scratch. So these are located only at one place. They may be due to the say local issue may be there, that's why it may have happened. It is not throughout the surface, so they are called as a flaws. So profile, it is the contour of any section. Sampling length, so sampling length, we are not assessing the entire surface of a particular component, we are taking a part of entire surface, or a small length of the entire surface is taken for the evaluation of the surface roughness. That length is called as the sampling length. Okay, so if your object is say 100 mm by 100 mm, so only say 5 mm, 10 mm part is taken for the study, for the evaluation. That is called as the sampling length. Okay, then lay, it is the direction of the predominant surface pattern, determine the production method. Means production method decides what is the predominant direction of the surface pattern. The predominant direction of the surface pattern can be, it can be parallel to the line representing the surface, it can be perpendicular to the line representing the surface, it can be angular, it can be multi-directional, and so on. So it is decided by the manufacturing process that you have adopted. That every manufacturing process has its own characteristics. So similarly, depending upon what kind of operation you have selected, that decides the lay. Okay, so lay of the milling can be different than the lay of the, say, turning. Lay of the broaching can be different than the lay of say turning. So like that, it may be different, lay may be different in different manufacturing processes. Then actual profile surface is the actual, it is a surface prescribed by the designer. So categories of the surface geometrical irregularities. The irregularities are classified as irregularities of the first order, second order, third order, and fourth order. Just we have seen in previous topic itself, we have seen what is the roughness, what is the waviness. Roughness is the irregularities of the third and fourth order, and waviness are the irregularities of the first and second order. So we'll see why these are generating the first order irregularities arising. Why they arise? They arise out of inaccuracies in the machine tool itself. If there is an inaccuracy in the machine tool itself, like lack of the straightness of the guideways on which the tool post is moving. So the tool post on which is on which the tool is moving, it itself the guideways may not be straight, so you may face the irregularities. It also includes irregularities arising due to the deformation of work under the action of the cutting forces and weight of the material itself. So whenever there is a contact between tool and workpiece, there is always going to be force, you can say there is exchange of the force, so it is going to be there. So they are called as they have been included as a second order irregularities. Then third order irregularities that develop due to cutting parameters like speed, feed, depth of cut. These are called as the irregularities of the third order, speed, feed, and depth of cut. Fourth order, these irregularities arise from rupture of material. Sometimes the material may get ruptured during the separation of the chip. So those are called as a fourth order irregularities. So in this types of the irregularities. So further, these irregularities are grouped under two groups, that is a primary texture and secondary texture, you can see here. So first group includes the irregularities of considerable wavelength. So irregularities are measured in terms of the wavelength. If that wavelength is more, okay, then that type of the, say, error, these errors are referred as a waviness. So large wavelength is there, or it is also referred as a secondary texture. So in case of the secondary texture, or it is called as a waviness. Then second group is called as a primary texture or roughness. In this, here the irregularities, the size of the irregularity is very less as compared to the previous one. Okay, so these are the irregularities of the small wavelength that is caused by direct action of the cutting elements, that is because of the direct action of the cutting elements. So these irregularities arise because of disturbances such as friction, wear or corrosion. So because of such say disturbances, these errors or these irregularities will arise, but their wavelength is very small, so they are referred as a roughness. So errors in this group are referred as a roughness or primary texture. Many times this question is asked, what is a write a short note on surface texture. Okay, so in that case you have to draw the sketch, you have to explain what is a primary texture, secondary texture, then various terminology related with the texture, that all these things you have to explain. Then this is a machining, this is symbol for the surface roughness. So we'll discuss this in the next lecture. We'll stop for time being.